There are many people who have considerable difficulty with the fact of homosexuality. Teachers for centuries have avoided this inquiry. Could you please, even briefly, put some light on this question? I have traveled 2,000 miles to ask this question. There are many people who have considerable difficulties with the fact of homosexuality. Teachers for centuries have avoided this question. I have traveled. Could you please even briefly answer this question? I have traveled 2,000 miles to ask this question. Sorry, quite right. I've traveled 2,000 years. This has been a question for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. It isn't something new. We are not taking sides in this matter. We don't condemn it or approve it or disapprove it. These are facts, right? As heterosexuality, it's a fact. Homosexuality exists in the world, in different parts of the world, very common. Other parts of the world is practically unknown. So how do you answer this question? What is the question? Why do we make it into such an enormous problem? Apparently, we don't make heterosexuality a problem at all. But we make this into a problem. Why? It's a fact. So should we inquire into this question, into heterosexuality and homosexuality differently? Not condemn one or the other, or approve one and deny the other, but inquire why sexuality, both, become such colossally important. Right? Why? You answer this question. And television, magazines, every bestseller has this element in it, in detail. Every day. You're following on? No, I don't have to tell you all this. Every day this is emphasized. Sexuality, I'm not talking about homo or heterosexuality, general sexuality. Why have human beings given such great importance to this? And if it's not important, you feel it, there's something wrong with you. That you're neurotic, that you have to fulfill, that you have, you know, dozens and dozens of explanations by the psychologists, by the experts, by the sexualists. Why? Is it pleasure? Remembrance in the pictures of sexuality. You understand? It's something. Why has man given throughout the ages such extraordinary importance to this. If you are deprived of it, you feel something terrible has happened. And you can voluntarily say, I won't have any, I'll become a celibate and join a monastery or not join a monastery or remain a celibate with all the problems of celibacy, right? So what is the question? Why has this thing given, has been given such a place in life? Part of life, right? Part of walking, seeing, running, laughing, tears, it's part of life. But why this one thing has taken importance? And is being encouraged very carefully, right? By the entertainment industry. Please go into all this. And the psychologists have also encouraged this. Fulfill. When some mothers feel something wrong with her daughter or son who doesn't have a boy or girlfriend after the age of 12, 13. This is all what's happening in the world, especially in this country. In the traditional countries like India and other countries, there's still, they said, please wait. Don't indulge. Wait till you're 20, 22, or whatever it is. So seeing all this, what does one learn from all this? Learn. Not moral. Not morality. Not celibacy. And so on. But what does one learn from all this? Come on, sirs. Religions throughout the world, the ancient, no, I won't call the very ancient, the Hindus, the Buddhists, the Christianity have always said, if you want to follow God, be a celibate. Why? And they take vows of celibacy, join monasteries, so become a monk, wandering monk, as they do in India, and go through tortures with this. Right? They've taken a vow. They must stick to it. I don't know why they take a vow first, but they must, once you have taken a vow, you have to follow that which you have accepted. But psychologically, inwardly, the glands, everything's a function, and you have a terrible time. The speaker has talked to many, many of them. They go through hell. Religion has done that. You know all this, don't you? And one asks, why has man said to himself, to achieve the most sublime, you must be a celibate? You understand? That is, you must torture yourself, go through agonies, and then you will be nearer God. Seems so childish, the whole thing. Sorry. I met many, many sannyasis in India, monks. I won't go to the details of it. They have tortured themselves in every way. Because the popular opinion is that to reach God, to reach the highest, you must live a life of absolute abstinence. Which means they don't human beings have never understood what is austerity. May we go into that? You're not bored with all this? I don't mind if you're bored. Probably you don't want to go into all this. It may disturb you very much. And please don't be disturbed, because it's this, we are dealing with facts. What is austerity? You know, the root meaning of that word, as we explained the other day, to be austere means to have, in Greek, a dry mouth. Not from drinks and all, a dry mouth, which is to be harsh, to be sharp, to be dry. And so gradually the human being has this idea that he must be austere, and has made himself into ashes. You understand? When you are forcing yourself day after day, month after month, year after year, driving yourself, you end up nothing as dry human being. And if you indulge also in the other direction, you have the same problem. So, can one live a life without conflict? You understand? Neither extremes can one, which imply conflict. The sensory demands and the suppression of sensory demands. Can one live without a single battle, effort, struggle between the two? You understand my question? That requires a great deal of inquiry into the whole problem of desire, will, wish, and the biological urges. Do you understand? Do you want to go on with this? There's a very good question at the end, I just saw it. How is one to live on this earth? Please listen to it. How is one to live on this earth without harm or destruction to its beauty, without bringing suffering and death to others? How is one to live on this earth without harm or destruction to its beauty, to the beauty of the earth, without bringing suffering and death to others? But we must finish our question which we were talking previously. What time is it, sir?
It's 20 to 1.
Could we bear another quarter an hour? Are you working the same as the speaker is working, or you just listen? Is your brain as active, working, inquiring, ducting, intends to find out to way of living something totally different? Tant pis. We were saying, to live a life without conflict requires an investigation into the whole question of desire. Which is a very, very complex problem. Should we really want to go into all that? No, I'm not asking out of encouragement. I'm just asking. It's a very serious thing what we are undertaking. It's no good just merely listening and repeating. That has no meaning at all. But seeing what facts are in this world, what is actually taking place in the world, not only in this country but in every country, in so-called every culture, and conflict in man is increasing more and more and more, not less and less. Man means woman and man, so please don't get excited about it. Why don't I talk about women? Unless one understands very deeply the movement of desire, not the description of it, not the explanation of it, but to inquire why desire becomes so extraordinarily important. Desire to become successful, desire to have money, desire for sex, for excitement, for amusement, you follow? The tremendous urge and the speed of it, and the demand for its fulfillment. Again, religions have said you must suppress desire, which means another battle, another conflict, another torture. You know, religion has played havoc with human beings. And they're still doing it, not only in the Christian world, but in the whole world, in the Islamic world. Look what they're doing in Iran and Iraq and, oh, good old talk. So, what is desire? Please understand, we are not trying to suppress it or encourage it, but it's a fact. The fact is that we are driven by desire. And thwarted is pain. Right? Sense of not being able to fulfill. So at any cost, at any price, we want the fulfillment of desire. You may say desire for God, desire for the understanding of, you know, all that. It's still desire. Gosh, must I go into all this? When you look at a tree and the beauty of the tree, the light upon the leaf, and there are mountains beyond it, the valleys, the shades, and the dappled light, and see that enormous beauty of the earth. That's a sensation. Right? I won't go into the question of is beauty sensation. I'm not going into that. That's another problem. No, not problem. That's quite another thing. Very interesting. If you go into it, is beauty sensation? When you see all that, the earth and its beauty, it's a sensation, right? Seeing with your, with the optical eyes, with the eyes, and the very seeing arouses the sensations, right? Seeing a beautiful woman or a man arouses various kinds of sensations. Then what, that sensation is correct, isn't it? Normal, healthy, natural. Unless one is paralyzed, blind, and deaf, dumb. That is, when one is sensitive. One is acutely aware of all this. And you see this, this perception of all this. Then what takes place? You're looking at those hills. The seeing of those hills arouses some sensations. Then what's the next step to that? Inquire, please. Look at it. Does then thought come in and say, what beautiful thing that is? Right? Thought then creates an image, right, out of that sensation. Well, right? I'm not saying anything that's not factual, it's not supposition or fictitious. Sensation, contact sensation, then thought makes an image of that sensation. Right? Are you following? When thought makes an image out of that sensation, then desire is born. Sensation is not desire.
Sensation, feeling a beautiful painting, but the sensation, then the heart says, I wish I had that to me. And the thought assumes the authority of the sensation, desire is born. And the question is, can sensation and thought be kept apart? Come to this. Not through will, through compassion, through effort, and all that. We're asking this a very serious and very simple. Sensation is natural. Thought is also somewhat natural. Is it feeling? That's what happens. Now, can there be a gap, an interval, a hiatus, so that sensation and thought are separate? Listen, see what this implies in it. It has caused tremendous effect. Seeing, sensation. I've seen some, especially since seeing some most beautiful things in the world. Beautiful colors. Beautiful people. Not people, I'm not even the comments of beautiful people. I'm really very, very. It's natural to look at this world as enormous beauty. The destruction of what human beings are doing to the earth. And see many of some of the most beautiful gardens in the world, houses, palaces, and so on. Lived in them and never to be identified with anything. I don't know this. Never asked if this has happened. Don't think that you can't accept some doctrine and some clarity. And all that implies the sense of great inward learning, which is discipline. Learning is discipline, not conformity.